this morning we gather to do two things. One of those things we do here regularly in Truelight on Sunday morning at this hour, and that is we gather to worship. It will be no different today. But in addition to worshiping, this is also a day about remembering. Is remembering 100 years ago when an evil fell over this city, exacting the lives of hundreds of African-American citizens of East St. Louis. It was a dark time. It was a day and a time of terror, horrific violence. But even in the midst of that darkness, there was a light that was shining in the valley.
Yes.
And that light was centered at Truelight Baptist Church.
Amen.
It would ring its bells 100 years ago to do two things. One, to warn people that violence was coming and that they should get to a place of safety. But secondly, and more importantly, it was to signal an alarm, to say that our work is not yet done, that evil will not win, that darkness, no matter how deep, would not overcome the light. And so this morning, sisters and brothers, we remember those 200 plus people who lost their lives. They are now sitting in the seat of honor, in a place of glory. And they are joining us this morning. Their spirits are here.
Yes.
And so this morning, we will ring the bell to remember that time.
Thank you.
us from the God that our spirits and our hearts as we invite our God into this space this morning. Help me, God, with how we thanksgiving. We come in thanksgiving because of who you are. We come in thanksgiving to give you honor and praise because you are a good and faithful God. You were faithful 100 years ago, oh God, and you are still faithful. And so we just stopped by this morning to praise you, to give you honor and glory this morning because you deserve the honor and the glory. We remember those saints, those brothers and sisters whose only defense 100 years ago in that great, great tragedy, only defense was you. I could hear them this morning, oh God, as the fires began to rain down, as the bullets began to fire, that they were calling on your name, just as we call on your name now, because we are still living in dark days. We are still living in evil times. Too many lives are still being lost to our streets. Too many black lives are still being lost to our streets. And so, God, we just implore you this morning to be with us, to be with us in this service, but to be with us in this journey of life, because you are our strength and you are our hope. We lift our voices to simply say, amen,
amen,
and amen.
Come on, man.
that's in the church that y'all dance. We don't do none of that stuff. We speak, okay? I mean, we speak publicly. Because I think you got to know how to present yourself to the public. Now, these young men have left. Now, we have some, my son who's gone, that he had been on this trip. We have some older guys that are, you know, they've been doing this for many, many years. And so what we decided to do on this trip is give somebody who's never had a chance. Instead, I'm going to throw out dead ringers and y'all be all impressed with them, right? But why not give somebody who never had a shot, because we already had the big time guys doing it before. So these are young men who never had that shot. So guys, they're going to be scared to death is what I'm telling you. But give them encouragement, okay? And the first one is, what we're talking about, the first one, they used to catch freight trains to come to East St. Louis. And what they would do is they would send advertisements down south to advertise for white people to come to work, and that's when they're rioting. Y'all know all that. So we found an article from that time period that he's going to recite what that article said to invite people to East St. Louis. So we wanted to be, and the other one talks about black donors. In other words, what kind of father really are you? Are you a father or are you a donor? So that's what the other three are going to talk about.
Hasten on my dark brother, duck the Jim Crow laws. No cracker there to seduce your sister, nor hang you to a limb. And you're not obliged to call them mister, nor show your teeth at them. Nor why should I remain longer south to be kicked and dogged around? Crackers there to knock me in my mouth and shoot my brother down? No, I won't. I'm leaving today. No longer can I wait. If the recruiter failed to take me away, I am bound to catch a free. Amen.
Gone, locked up, untrustworthy, not dependable. Yes, this aptly describes the donor that shook my mother's hand, if you know what I mean. Whisper quietly in her ear about extravagant dreams, without real plans, without any means. As I transgressed my mother's warm, dark womb with a glimmer of great expectations, one of those expectations was the strong arm of my father to guide me. He was not there. He was gone like the next morning dew, finding more important things to do with his crew. Father, you were supposed to be my GPS. You led my mother faster than FedEx and UPS, dropping up a package at the front door as you hastily slipped out the back door, conveniently. Why do I want to know you so bad? Excellent question. Without the guidance I shall reveal in my freedom, without the boundaries this very freedom has imprisoned me, both metaphorically and literally. Every kid desires to hear his father say no. No has never come from your mouth. Boundaries to you have never existed because you never existed. Not metaphorically, literally. Wow.
Yes, I'm hurting. Tell you different would be a bold-faced lie. Can't count the times I wanted to roll up in a big ball, slip and cry, or just die. My brother delivered a rather gloomy picture of the side. Now it's my chance to serve you slice of my sweet. And let me emphasize sweet potato pie. One look at me, and most girls say I'm stacked. I'm inspired, motivated, determined, and black. Say it loud,
I'm black, I'm proud.
It's black men that give us a chance to return from the brink, building strong black families, making that eternal marriage link. And as a bow tie boy, I refuse to blame. My earthly father, he wasn't the best. No need to explain, you know the rest. He just couldn't pass the manhood test. Rest assured, his family crest doesn't grace my chest. Doesn't grace it all. I order Jesus Christ and Him crucified, for Him I'm willing to live or die.
Dr. King's dream has lost some of its steam. Let me show you what I mean. We have abortion on demand, no Bibles in our land, no prayers in our schools, boys in the girls' restroom, no gods in our pledge, using race as a wedge. This is not a dream, but a nightmare. Dr. King gave his all, yet there's still hate in the school hall. They can't teach us how to read, it's a crying shame indeed. The new boys are on the right track, and it's best we don't turn back. To God's word we must cleave, stand strongest about what we believe. We believe in God the Father, we believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in resurrection that's given us new life. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's coming back again. We believe, praise God, we believe.
All right.
Hey, it's Truelight, y'all. That's all I can say. It's Truelight. If you didn't know, now you know. Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm going to do something a little different so that we might be able to save a little time. Normally on first Sunday, we recognize wedding anniversaries, we recognize birthdays. Same as the other. I'm going to postpone that, if you all don't mind, to next Sunday. Amen. 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 I can take 30 minutes if we can do it if y'all want to. Okay, all right. Something I won't postpone or do differently. Something I will not change is an opportunity for us all to be involved. Now, visitors, right away, you think I'm talking about an offer. I'm not. Too many times we put God on the clock. What I mean by that, we have a regimen. We do this and we do that. Oftentimes, we don't take time out to do something simple called prayer. I am going to do something a little different because I'm faced with a situation that in the 5.5 years as a pastor, I've not been faced with. I'm going to ask Mr. James Townsend to come forth. And I'm going to ask a few of the men of Truelight to come forth. Mr. Townsend is being shipped out to Kuwait. He'll be leaving shortly. He is expected to be there for at least a year. So I just want us to take a little time so that we might pray God's protection upon this brother. And I don't know who you're sitting next to, but I always say this. If you can't hold their hand right now, move. Lord, keep your touch of mercy and grace upon him. Lord, Lord, guide his footsteps like never before. Protect him. Let him know that he is your child. Lord, as he goes off to honor this country, help this country to be willing to honor him. Lord, he's going to a foreign land to risk his life, yet we have young men and women risking their lives in our streets every day. So Lord, just as I'm asking you to protect him in a foreign country, Lord, protect us in this place that we call home. Lord, on this day, the day in which history forces us to look back 100 years and lives that were lost, help us to remember, Lord, that because of you, a bell rang out and lives were saved. Now, Lord, as we prepare for the preaching moment, I should ask that you would hide me behind your wings, dip me down in your wings. Lord, when you open my mouth, let it be your words that flow forth. Let them be words of comfort, words of concern, words of strength, and words of soothing. Lord, we forever will give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. These are all things we ask in your precious Son. It is in Jesus Christ's name that this family of believers says, amen.
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 Not be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but
was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need.
Yes, sir.
You may be seated. I should like to add for content an excerpt from Harper Barnes' book, Never Been a Time. It reads as follows. Before midnight, police began receiving reports that armed black men were assembling in the South End. Night Police Chief Con Hickey was on the phone talking to one of the callers when another line rang, and Cub reporter Roy Albertson of the St. Louis Republic picked up the receiver. A grocer named James Riley, who lived on 18th Street south of Vine Avenue, said more than 100 armed blacks had gathered in his neighborhood, summoned by a church bell. "It's ringing now," the grocer said. "If you listen, you can hear it.
Don't you see?
It's ringing now.
It's ringing now.
If you listen, you can hear it." I want to speak from the subject, who's ringing the bell?
All right, Pastor.
Who's ringing the bell? You know, Hebrews is one of only two letters in the New Testament that lack a greeting or the identification of its author. Many people attribute it to Paul, but as we are finding with many of the other writings of Paul, more than likely it was someone who wrote in the characteristics of Paul. It was possibly a follower of Paul that wrote this letter. But one of the things I find interesting about this author is that in his writing, he writes as if he knows his audience. He's writing as if he knows the people he's writing to, and the people that he's writing to knows him. Mm-hmm. You know, as I was thinking about this day, and I thought we'd probably have some visitors, but if you all don't mind, I'm gonna preach like I know y'all. And I'm gonna preach like y'all know me. So if I cuss, my true life wants to tell you it's okay, Pastor Cuss. My mama had already got mad. So if some things slip out, it's okay. One of the other interesting things about the book of Hebrews, it's actually been called the roots of the New Testament. You all remember the Alex Haley book, 1976, it came out. Actually, you probably remember the movie, but the book was actually published in 1976, and it talked about his descent from Africans and him coming up in America. One of the interesting things about the book of Hebrews is that it's talking to some Jews who have become Christian, and they are struggling with leaving their past behind. They are struggling with what they were, trying to become what it is that God wants them to be. Somebody ought to be listening right now. They were struggling with who it is that they were and what they were accustomed to, and what it is that God was calling for them to be. I want to talk to some Christians right now, some so-called saved folks. I have a question. Y'all ever get so mad you cuss? I'm sorry, I was talking Christians. I know y'all been saved so long that y'all have forgot what cuss words are. But you ever get so upset that one accidentally slips out? Oh, I'm sorry, this group right here, they too saved. Let me go over here. Where am I saying cusses at? Somehow I knew. The cat was sitting up there right there. So you have
have this group of people and they're struggling with changing their lives and being something different from that which they've always been. They're struggling with being labeled a certain way. Y'all missed that. They're struggling with being labeled a certain way. Now I want you to understand something. This letter is to church folk. See, oftentimes when we get into the Bible and we look at what's there, we think they're talking to somebody out of the world, but 99.9% of what it is that you read in the Bible is talking to church folk, Christian folk, saved folk. And so often the mistake that preachers make is we have to relate to them in such a way that they understand. Y'all don't understand. But I'm going to try to make it plain. Jesus is talking to converted Jews, converted from Judaism. And he uses a term that they're very familiar with in the text. He says, seeing that we have a great high priest. I got any Old Testament folks in here? In the Old Testament, the book entitled Exodus, the 28th chapter, it describes a garment that Aaron, who was the high priest, has to wear. And the high priest was tasked with going into the Holy of Holies and going before God so that the nation's sins could be forgiven. And there was a certain process and certain things that he had to do to ensure that those sins would be forgiven. But if you go and read, because I know y'all do, because that's what we do at Truelight. See, they don't trust me, so when I give them a text, they go back and read it to make sure I ain't lying to them. Okay? But if you go back and you read that, and it starts describing the garment. And the one thing I want you all to pay attention to is it talks about at the hem of his garment, they were to weave in golden bells. And then if you read, I believe it's the 35th verse, it says, and it shall be upon Aaron to minister. And his sound shall be heard when he goeth in unto the holy place of the Lord and when he cometh out. What they're saying is that once Aaron steps behind the veil, the only way that you knew Aaron was doing what it is that Aaron was supposed to be doing is because you could hear the bells. They missed that. The only way that you knew that Aaron was doing what he was supposed to be doing is because every time Aaron moved, you can hear the bells.
Yes, sir.
The bells ringing. What I'm trying to say to you folks, if you're Christian, like you say you're Christian, every time you move. Sorry, I didn't miss it already. I don't want you to miss this piece.
Yes.
It says, so you can hear the sounds when he goes into and when he comes out of. I'm going to ask the question, who's ringing the bell? Why is the church folks only ring the bell when they're in church? And a hush fell over the crowd. See, we don't have a problem talking about what's wrong in this society. We don't have a problem talking about what needs to be fixed as long as we're in church. But when we get out of church, when we take the robe off, who's ringing the bell? We get quiet. When we keep up a whole lot of noise, we do a whole bunch of jumping and shouting when we in church. But when we out of church, I tell you my folks all the time, I can't stand punk Christians. I don't like soft, y'all. We got too many folk running around talking about they saved and talking about they this and talking about they that until something happens.
Yes.
See, we don't mind getting out in front of the camera for publicity.
Yes.
But I got a question, East St. Louis.
Yes.
What are you going to be doing tomorrow?
Yes,
sir. Oh, that's why. I got a question, East St. Louis. What are you going to be doing next week? I got a question. See, we got to stop treating our problems and our blackness like Halloween.
popular and it's comfortable, we put our blackness on.
Nah.
There's all these festivities and things going on, we don't have a problem being black. But when Halloween's over, Red, why are you fussing? Why are you? We got guests, Red, why are you talking about that? Because if there's never time to be real, right now is the time to be real. So I ask the question, who's ready to bear? How black are you going to be tomorrow? And for those of you who are ignorant, who ain't black, how supportive are you going to be tomorrow? See, I'm not here for applause. Mm-hmm. I'm not here to put on a show.
Yes, sir.
But I have to ask a question. Who's ringing the bell?
Who's ringing the bell?
When I saw these young men on yesterday, and I stepped on the bus, and they were all dressed alike, and they were respectful, and I got choked up. Because that's not the picture that's being painted as it relates to our young black boys in this country. I had the opportunity to shake someone's hand and talk to them. They were yes, sir, and no, sir. And that's not. And hold up. Their pants was pulled up. That's not the picture that's being depicted. You know why their pants was pulled up? Because a man named Brad Pearson didn't have a problem with the bell. And this message is from that man, from God. So when I ask the question, who's ringing the bell? Stop looking for somebody else to ring it. When if you're a Christian, you ought to be able to ring it for yourself. Problems, we see issues, we see things that need to be addressed. Let me go to the mountain. Let me call somebody. When you ought to address the issue. In Michael Barnes' book, the grocer said, the bells are ringing. If you listen, you can hear them.
Yes.
I ask you a question. If you listen, do you hear any bells ringing? And if they're ringing, are they ringing loud enough? Are they dealing with real issues? Or are we satisfied dealing with issues until somebody lines our pocket and then we ain't got to deal with the issues no more? Then it becomes somebody else's problem. I'm going to say it again. Because I didn't get enough response. Let me tell you something about the black church. Let me tell you something about the Baptist church. You have what you call call and response. And I'm going to tell you how an old preacher used to preach. If he didn't get enough response, he just kept on calling.
Yes, yes.
Amen.
Preach that.
Amen.
This author says that we have, seeing that we have a great high priest,
yes,
who has passed into heaven. God is an awesome God. God is an amazing God. You have Jesus the Christ who's passed through 42 generations so that he could be our high priest. And he's given the sacrifice. Mm-hmm. Now he's done everything that it is that he needs to do. Mm-hmm. And yet we still wait on Jesus to do more. Mm-hmm. When the author says, come boldly before the throne of grace. Mm-hmm. Come boldly before the throne of grace. Stop looking for other people to do the things that you know need to be done. Come boldly,
yes,
when there's a problem. Come boldly. When our students aren't graduating, come boldly.
Right.
When they're being pulled over for no reason, come boldly.
That's right.
Instead of whispering, they're trying to find out who's going to ring the bell.
Mm-hmm.
If I sit on the bell, you know how to ring?
Don't ring.
That's why he said, the bells are ringing. If you listen, you can hear it. But if the only bells you know how to ring, are bells that are only for your self-gratification. See, Hebrews talks about these Jews who were running into the struggle, and what the struggle was other Christians didn't want to work with them. Mm-hmm. See, there's this phenomenon in Western society called cocooning. Mm-hmm. And it's invaded the church. And what cocooning is, as it relates to Christianity, is when we just deal with God as it relates to us. Mm-hmm. Lord, help me. Mm-hmm. Lord, fix me. And it's, when it's just about us, or it's just about our church. Mm-hmm. But that's not the Christ that we serve. The Christ that we serve wants us to work together so that we're doing things collectively so that it will benefit the whole. Mm-hmm. Now I'm going to make some folks mad.
But this is my church.
No, folks, church is saying, well, hey, Reverend, when you going to join this organization? When's Truelight going to join that? I ain't down with none of those. But when I talk to people about the benefit, they can't tell me what the benefit is. I got a better question. Churches, when you going to take care of something more than just the property that your building sits on? I'm talking about us too. Truelight, when are we going to be concerned about Tudor and not just 1535 Tudor? When are we going to be concerned about the South End and not just where Rock is? Who's ringing? Who's ringing the bell? Brother Pearson, I appreciate it. That brother stood here and cried about his love for East St. Louis. Mm-hmm. And in case you missed it, he said this is the first time that he's ever been here. Mm-hmm. When are you going to shed a tear for that? Oh, I know, y'all like me. Mm-hmm. I grew up in Centerville, and I moved to O'Fallon. Mm-hmm. So I moved up the hill. Right? I'm George Jefferson. I moved on up. So I don't look back at what's going on in Centerville. Uh-huh. East St. Louis is not a place to escape from. Yeah. East St. Louis is a place to go back to. Y'all miss that. East St. Louis is not a place. Y'all would be quiet when I talk about East St. Louis. But when you get your repo, you're not saved moment. Yeah. You ain't up in no fountain then. Yeah, but you in your not so saved moment. Yeah, you're hanging out in certain places. I see these guys laughing because they know I'm telling the truth. You ain't got a problem with East St. Louis when you getting your free ball. When you all sing, you're one with the Lord. You don't want to go down to East St. Louis. East St. Louis is not a place to escape. East St. Louis is a place to embrace.
Yes.
You know, I didn't know the history. I didn't, as I'm reading this book and it's talking about lawyers and doctors, black lawyers and doctors living in East St. Louis, bankers living in East St. Louis, businesses flourishing in East St. Louis.
That's right.
We have not because we know not.
That's right.
You don't know your history, you'll repeat your history. And wow, it was a trap. time. Let us not forget that because somebody rang a bell, some lives were saved.
That's right.
In East St. Louis. Let us not forget, though the history books may say 45 to 250 people died, what they're reluctant to say is that because some black people stood up for themselves, their thousands of lives were saved because somebody rang the bell.
Preaching red. Man, go ahead.
Somebody.
Help yourself.
Somebody ring the bell.
Oh, yeah.
I'm so glad that it doesn't tell us who rang the bell. It doesn't say the pastor rang the bell. Somebody rang the bell. It doesn't say the usher rang the bell. Somebody rang the bell. It doesn't say a cop rang the bell. Some people have been a janitor. But somebody rang. Somebody. Who's ringing the bell? Will you ring the bell? Will you ring the bell? Will you ring the bell? Somebody needs to ring the bell.
Amen.
I was reading the book and they had me crying.
Yes, yes.
Because though hundreds, maybe even thousands of blacks escaped across the bridges, then they shut down the bridges. So that people didn't have an escape route. Yeah. Oh, God is something else, honey. God is amazing. Because even 100 years ago, when they shut off the bridges, when they shut off the ways to escape, some Christian folk who happened to be white opened their doors and said, come on in here. Speak out. Come on in. What am I saying? I'm saying to that. It doesn't just have to be black folks. That's ringing the bell. If this place is going to get better, it's going to take a whole bunch of folks to ring the bell. Not just black, it's going to take some white folks to ring the bell. Seeing that we have a great high priest,
yes.
Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need.
Yes,
is this a time of need?
Yes, sir.
Stop acting like we don't need. Stop acting like there's nothing going on. Stop acting like everything is going to be okay. It's not. Until somebody, anybody, rings the bell.
Man.
I'm ready to go home. Oh, I'm sorry, I can't go home. We got programs all day. But I want us to understand I read somewhere where it said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Who's ringing the bell for the poor? He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. Who's ringing the bell for those who need some healing?
That's Isaiah.
To recover sight to the blind. Who's ringing the bell for people who have been blinded by greed, blinded by hypocrisy? Who's ringing the bell? To those who are captive, to those who are locked up, to those who are in prison for injustices, in prison for reasons that other folks aren't locked up. Who's ringing? Who's ringing the bell? Don't leave here if you're not able to answer that question. Don't leave here if you're not willing to ring one of those bells. I don't care who you are, I don't care what your position is in life. God is calling for you to ring the bell. Salvation is not just about you. But we are all called, commanded by God to go out into the world and to ring the bell.
Amen.
Amen.
A 100 years ago, a bell. That bell sits in that tower. But the bell that rings now doesn't have to be a stationary bell. All right. That's sitting in the tower of the church. Mm-hmm. The bells that need to ring are the people who are sitting in the seats in the churches. Uh-huh. So when you go out, wherever it is that you go to, let that bell ring. Mm-hmm. Ring for somebody other than yourself. Ring for somebody that needs some help. And all of us know somebody that needs help.
Yeah.
I have a question. Is everything in the world okay?
No.
Is everything the way that it needs to be?
No.
Then who's ringing the bell? Get ready.
Great having the Bowtie Boys and individuals such as Mr. Pearson here in East St. Louis, and a camaraderie and understanding that it's not just blacks in East St. Louis, blacks in Dallas, but we are, as a people, all over in all humanity. So we're proud to have he and his young men, not boys, his young men here to commemorate, not celebrate, to commemorate this event, that we will move forward as a nation as we grow in our times.
And so what do you guys think about the sermon on today?
Who's gonna ring the bell? Who's ringing the bell? I thought that was an amazing sermon, very appropriate for what we're trying to do. We need every person in East St. Louis to pick up their bell and ring. So I think it was a great sermon.
Yeah. I think it was absolutely appropriate, and we're gonna ring the bell on that bridge today, I guarantee you.
Mr. Brown.
I think the sermon was very timely, and it also was a challenge, because too often, as he states, we're in church and we're Christian, but outside, I've often said, you can tell a Christian, they don't have to say, I'm a born-again Christian, because their light shines, as it's told biblically. So I think we have to get beyond the four walls in our churches and do the work outside. The real work is done outside of the church.
Thank you, gentlemen.